Simone, who is the editor emeritus of Fangoria.
Hey, welcome to Comic-Con to the special presentation on Resident on Silent Hill Revelation 3D. Yes. On October 26th, the phenomenal franchise Silent Hill is going to go deeper, deeper into 3D with Silent Hill Revelation 3D. Yeah, with an all-star genre cast here to tell us all about it. Let's have a big welcome for the writer, director of the film. His other credits include Solomon Kane, great Robert E. Howard movie, currently on VOD. Also, he directed the great British chillers Death Watch and Wilderness. Let's give it up for Michael J. Bassett. Now, we also have the producer of the film. His credits include the Resident Evil series, True Romance, Brotherhood of the Wolf, Solomon Kane, Crying Freeman. Let's give it up for Samuel Hadida. Making her major screen debut is a lovely Australian actress in the lead of Silent Hill Revelation. Let's give it up for Adelaide Clemens. Game of Thrones fans. Well, Jon Snow himself is with us today. Let's give it up for Harrington. And how'd you like to see the trailer for Silent Hill Revelation 3D in 3D, no less? Put on your 3D glasses right now. We're going to go straight to...
So now she's 18 and she grew up and we had to wait the time that she grew up. So in 2012, she's 18 and she's here.
That works. And Michael, this is your introduction to the Silent Hill franchise. What attracted you to the project and what elements of the Konami game did you strive to bring to the movie?
It's my introduction to the movie, but I've been playing the games for, since I was... 2006, when the first one came out. So, it's an incredible opportunity. I worked with Samuel and Solomon Kane, and I really admired the first Silent Hill for its aesthetic. I loved how it tried to capture what the game world was. When he came and said, we want to make another one, it felt logical to me to take game three and to tell that story of little Sharon slash Cheryl, depending whether you play the game or watch the movie. She's grown into Heather. And there's not many movie worlds you can play in like Silent Hill. I mean, really, it's a hugely atmospheric, deep, meaningful world. It's a horror movie, so we get to spill some blood and scare the shit out of you. And at the same time, you get to create and work with an aesthetic which is pretty unique. And the games themselves have set such a benchmark for what is quality game storytelling and myth-making. The chance to do that on the big screen is too good to miss. So it was a great opportunity, and I hope I've done justice to the kind of the aesthetic and creative qualities of the games, as well as the movie that came before us.
Well, a lot of the fans of games criticize the movies that are made from the games because they feel that they're not enough like the games. It seems like you've gone in the opposite direction and really strove to put elements of the game, especially the third one, as you said, into the movie.
I have, but I also profoundly disagree that a game and a movie are the same thing. So an adaptation of a game should not be a slavish retelling of the game story. They do different things. With a game, you're interacting, you're peeling back the world for yourself and making your own choices. With a movie, you're being told a story which should immerse you and should carry you on an adventure. So they are different things, and I wanted to make a movie which is true and honest to what the games are, but at the same time, there's no challenge in literally retelling the story. So we took elements of Game 3, which I think along with Game 2 may be the best of the series. I had to make a movie that was a sequel to the first story, so it made sense logically and as a logical progression. I had to adapt Game 3 so the story was the kind of the foundation for it, and make a movie which worked for people who had never seen Silent Hill, game or movie, didn't give a shit, and just wanted to have a really entertaining horror movie. So those three things together kind of were the pressures to make that story. So I hope I've done it.
Cool. Adelaide and Kit, could you tell us about the characters you played in Silent Hill Revelation?
Yeah, I play Heather Mason. He's a seventh.
Heather Mason fans out there in the games? Yeah! Right.
And he's a 17-year-old girl, and basically he's been on the run with her father, played by Sean Bean, and a series of events kind of happen, these nightmarish kind of happenings, and she gets sucked into the world of Silent Hill. So, yeah.
And Pip?
Yes. I play Vincent, and I can't tell you a hell of a lot about him. because I don't want to, as always, spoil anything, and with him there are some surprises. So if you know the game, you'll know the character Vincent from Silent Hill 3. He does differ somewhat in the movie. We changed him, but I hope you'll like the changes. I'm not going to say too much because I don't want to spoil it for you.
Yeah. So I mean, if you come in with an expectation it's the same Vincent from the game, then you're going to be either surprised or disappointed. But if you look at him as a new character doing new things with the sort of the DNA of what Vincent from the game was, then I think you'll understand and be interested in him. But as Kit says, you can't say too much about him, but it does rather spoil.
In regards to the 3D, Samuel, this isn't your first rodeo. Your last few films have all been in 3D. The cast and Michael, could you talk about the challenges of working in 3D? Which is incredible in the film, by the way. I saw it this morning, the 3D effects are just amazing. You get sucked into the Silent Hill world.
I'm gonna get on my 3D hobby horse right now. So I know a lot of you guys out there don't like 3D and you think it's not being used right. When Sammy and I first talked about putting the movie together, 3D was put on the table and I was somewhat reluctant to embrace it. But then you think about what you're doing with a movie like Silent Hill and you are creating worlds. You're trying to do something different. You're trying to immerse the audience. And 3D is a new tool for that. It takes some things off the table and introduces new artistic and aesthetic things. We shot it in 3D. There is no post 3D. On the set, we could go and look at the 3D that we were shooting and adjust the depth of the world that you were experiencing. Much the way that you pull focus in a film these days, and you have a focus puller, and that's part of the camera team. Now you have a stereographer who sits alongside you and controls the depth and the use of the 3D. And technically it's a complete pain in the ass because the cameras were big and unwieldy and it slows you down. But I think what it does, it allows you to sort of step through that kind of proscenium arch into the world. And yes, we do have stuff come out at you, and yes, we do have fun with it occasionally, but it seemed to me that the point of Adelaide Heather's journey into this world was to get more and more immersed in this new universe, and 3D was a great device for that. And I would add that, you know, we made the movie in 3D. If you don't see it in 3D, you're really not seeing the movie that we made, because it was shot for 3D, it was edited for 3D. Even the sound design is designed to sort of use those extra dimensions in a movie theater. So all the naysayers, you know, give it a chance, because it's pretty decent.
And Adelaide and Kit, talk about your 3D experience.
Yeah, I mean, I think 3D is the perfect marriage between a video game and a film. It just, it makes sense, it makes complete sense to me. And I think it was definitely a little bit, it was time consuming, and there were challenges, and physically, I know that far more dynamic, obviously, you're in 3D, so had to be aware of that, but I thought it was really fascinating and wonderful to be a part of it, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it was really exciting. I was warned by Michael coming into it that it would be very time consuming and the setups would take a long time, and I think I was expecting a lot worse. It's actually, you know, as far as acting goes, like Adelaide says, you have to be aware sometimes that this is a 3D shot, that you're going, your hand is going to be coming out of the screen, and your hair is going to be swooshing in a certain way or something, I don't know.
Particularly kids' hair. Let's face it, it's lovely.
as it happens for an, I think it's incredibly different for cameramen and crew, but for an actor, it's you're still playing a scene, you're still acting, so it's not a huge difference.
For you, Samuel, is it getting any easier having made this as like a fourth 3D film?
But I think that fourth Sanatir is really perfect because you don't want to see just things coming at you. We had experience, you know, oh, 3D is only things going toward you, and you know, it's a bit of a gimmick, you know. But in this particular movie, you are completely immersed. When you are in a town that you don't know, that is out of the world, and it's a new experience for you coming through this world, you have the same feeling in 3D because the ash is now perceivable. It's not 2D. There is this extra layer that you just feel into you. And when everything comes and change and there is the darkness and it's like floating around you, it's like you are part of the movie in 3D. But it's the same feeling that we had when originally we played a game and where you are in the dark and you're playing this video game and you say, follow this, and you're in the dark and you find this music around you. You have an extra sensitivity. This will bring with this 3D and this extra dimension. And I think and Michael has played with it very perfectly. So that's why.
Well, speaking of 3D, how would you folks like to see the first ever 3D featurette making of?
Yeah. We shot even the interview in 3D, just to give you everything possible.
All right, so put those specs back on your faces and check.
Yeah, I mean, you can't really get away from making a modern movie at some digital work. And, you know, you embrace that as you go along. But for me, I'm a bit of an old school horror movie fan, so I want my monsters standing in front of me on the set. Yes! Give it up for men suits. So the thing about the monsters in Silent Hill, mostly they're kind of corruptions of the human form one way or the other, so it's relatively easy to find a way of making them exist with a makeup work or a costume work of some kind. And to me, the important thing is to create a world that the actors can exist in and give their best work to. So there's only one fully digital creature in Silent Hill, which you're going to meet in a little while. And it's a fantastic creation. I'm incredibly proud of it, but for me, more than anything, it is about putting the real monster in front of the performers so that they can respond in an appropriate way. I mean, you know, Red Pyramid, we have brain monsters with weird cranial surgery going on, and we have, you know, the Leonard monster and things like that. So I'm working with Paul Jones, who is really one of the best creature builders out there based out of Toronto. Patrick Tartopoulos came along again from the first movie to help kind of refine some of the designs. It was a great team creatively behind it, and I think it really benefits the performers as well. But I mean, you guys can speak to that. Because I know that I didn't want to put a tennis ball in front of you and say, hey guys, this is going to be really scary in 6 months. React.
No, I think it's the greatest blessing as an actor to have a director who was willing to invest in those monsters. I think there's something else as well, is that, you know, not only was Red Pyramid standing 10 feet tall, wielding an axe double my height, and you know, and I was expected to fight him. But also that, you know, that stuntman who played Red Pyramid.
Roberto,
you know, he became a friend, and he has a personality of his own, and he breathed life into that character, and the performance just could increase, and it was.
Well, you can direct the monster as well. That's the other thing. You can say less, more, this, that. And particularly, the guy who played Red Pyramid is also responsible for the creature movements of everybody. So, and he played Pyramid in the first movie, so he was familiar and could develop and enhance. So, it really is.
Made it beautiful,
yeah,
in a way.
I mean, it makes it beautiful. There is a thing about the Silent Hill monsters. They're supposed to be hideous and beautiful. It's the kind of the glory and the disgust of the human body all at the same time. It's one of the key things about Silent Hill, corruption of flesh, I think.
Yeah. I just think as well as having a dialogue with the person playing that monster, as you can't have a dialogue with a CGI stick. That's one thing, but also it's kind of, someone said to me recently that, like, because of how amazing CGI has become, the spectacle is dead. Mm. That if you can make a building jump across a road, then no one's surprised by anything anymore. And I think that's quite interesting. And with this movie, we have some wonderful CGI elements. We have an amazing scene in it, which I think is fantastic and brilliantly done. But at the same time, you've got real visceral things you can see and touch. And I think that makes all the difference in this movie, actually.
I don't know how Kate would have been scared around the nurses if they were digital.
Yeah, those nurses,
Hey, how about some questions from you folks for our illustrious panel? By the pillar. Go ahead. Shout real loud.
There's a mic.
There's a mic right here.
Make your way to the audio device.
Yeah, if anyone else has a question, yeah, just sit down to the mics. We'll start with this guy right here. Go ahead.
Is it on?
Yep.
Hi, my question is for Michael. I saw Solomon and Cain. It's on demand, so I paid like the $10.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Not quite in profit yet, but thank you.
It was really good. I work for a theater, and we got in an early print of Silent Hill, and we actually started to watch it.
Oh, you're Batman.
Sorry.
Security.
It was amazing, though. It's really good.
Well, then you can watch the rest of it, then, if you have a nice about it.
Right. I was wondering though, like, I read online a few future projects you were doing, but are you doing anything else action-wise in the future? Because if not, I really would like to see if you could do a Bioshock movie.
Oh. Hell yeah. I think I've got to rest out of Gore Verbinski's cold dead hand, haven't I? Bioshock, hell yeah, that'd be fantastic.
Yeah, because you've done now, I guess Solomon Kane could be considered an action horror film.
Yeah.
Because you've done two action horror films now.
Yeah.
And they were both amazing, so I think Bioshock would be great.
You're very kind, you can come home with me. Thank you. I agree with everything you said. And by the way, Silent Hill just gets better. If you've only watched the first reel, it just keeps
going. Yeah, we started watching it, but it was like 5 a.m. and we all had work at 8 o'clock, so right. We decided to...
I got in the light there.
It's a treat for you on the 26th then.
Thank
26th
you.
Of October, theaters near you.
Hey. I just wanted to ask, how much did you guys play the games to do research for the movie? What were your favorite parts?
Okay, I've only been playing games since I was a kid, and so, survival horror kind of happened with Silent Hill 1, I think. I mean, I played Alone in the Dark and those kind of games, but it was just kind of polygons moving around, and even that was kind of creepy. The first Silent Hill, I think one of the reasons it worked for me is it was lo-fi in a way. It was hard. I'm lousy at joystick controlling. I'm a PC man. Give me a first-person shooter any day. But that world in the game environment was just absolutely, it was seminal. It really was. But partly it's because of the sound design. As much as anything, I mean, the creatures are great, the story's fantastic, but Akira and that team from Konami, when they put them, they took music and they took the sound design and kind of made them one entity, which was just amazing. There's an argument that 2 is the best game in the series, and I think 3 is the best story. Anyone play Downpour, the new one?
Yeah!
We've got Downpour fans? Okay, yeah, I mean, I've been away working, so I've only played halfway through that, but it seems to me there's a bit that the better the graphics get, the kind of less scary it is. I quite like the dirt and the grunge, you know? So, I mean, I'm a gamer. I had to go back and relearn about them, I have to say, because I hadn't played them for a long time. The other thing we got is we got the kind of the Bible from Konami, just all the detail, the mythology, the research. And what's incredible is that the stuff is when I play, I just kind of play to get through the game, kill the monsters, that kind of stuff. And then you go back and you realize the mythology and the depth of the storytelling that's going on in there, and all the clues you miss and the Easter eggs that are built into stuff. So when we made the movie, we tried to put some Easter eggs and things in there. So for the game fans who really know Game 3, there are visuals which are hopefully frame for frame what you played. It may go past pretty quickly, but you will be able to stop and go, that's in the game. You know, the stuff on the merry-go-round at Lakeside Amusement Park, things like that. You know, that's what we try and do, and just bring that in. So I'm a bit of a gamer. I know these guys weren't so much, because
I was in Nintendo 64 days. But yeah, and I have two younger brothers, and I'm very competitive, so they're boys, and I'm not kind of technologically.
They're boys. I think there's a few girl gamers here, aren't there?
Yeah!
There you go.
You play it for me.
Yeah, I'm terrified of it. I played it for like 10 minutes and I had to go and hide under the covers. I'm serious, it scares the crap out of me.
You're not old enough because when I'm scared, 10 minutes after I say to myself, can you continue please and play? And I have to be near him and in the dark and everybody is scared. And I say, we have to buy the right of making this movie because it's fantastic.
Well, the thing of it is you have to remember, Samuel got the rights to Silent Hill because his son Laurent, who was actually now one of the producers of this movie all these years later, was playing it just in the house. And Sammy watched him and said, what the hell is this? Because Laurent was, I'm so scared of this game, Dad. And
I cannot play it alone.
Yeah, and this movie, the first movie and this one, grew out of the fact that there are fans making this. Now, you may not like what we've done with it, but we've done it in a way because we're fans. And Laurence is sitting down there, and it's kind of his fault any of this exists, because he was scared as a kid. So, you've got to blame him for that, really.
Yeah, question on the screen.
Kit, you were awesome in Game of Thrones.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. I love Jon Snow. Fallen Angel Vital, the Archangel Metatron, show the seal, the game, was the movie going to be?
Slow down, say again.
Okay, as for the Halo of the Sun,
yes.
The Fallen Angel Vital and the Archangel Metatron, yes. And the seal of Metatron, is the movie going to get more in detail why she called upon Metatron as an act of God, except God for himself? because I played all the games and that answer is still...
As an extra layer, you will find the solution, but the other you understand just the basic.
Well, I'll tell you a couple of things. Obviously, the Halo of the Sun is the iconic image in terms of the graphic. The Seal of Metatron is, I kind of went for that as one of the key elements in this, because when you play the game, and this is, as I understand it, you probably learned more than me, but the Seal of Metatron doesn't really do anything, right? It's a thing, it's an arcane object. And I wanted an object which was part of the game, part of the game mythology, but was a little bit fuzzy about what it really did. And the guys at Konami said the same. They said, yeah, it's a thing, it's great, and I like the imagery of it, and I have a Seal of Metatron at home now. It's a great object, it's fantastic. So, do we go with vomiting gods up and things like that at the end? You're going to have to go and see the movie to see if that's the direction we're going. This is an adaptation of that story. It doesn't go all the ways you think it's going to go. And are your questions answered? Is Valtiel there in body, if not in spirit?
Okay, center guy.
For continuity, what other games would you like to bring to movies in the Silent Hill universe?
Oh, in the Silent Hill world? Shadow of Memories is pretty good. I like it because it replays a lot of stuff and does it differently. The truth is, I would like to play in the Silent Hill universe without using the games as a framework anymore. I think you look at some of the graphic novels that have been done of it, they're telling interesting stories. I love I can't remember the name right now, the one that's set in the kind of the pioneer town when Silent Hill was just developing. I think that backstory, when it was a prison colony, those kinds of things, those are cool stories to tell. I like the story behind Downpour. I think the prisoners are going in there, and if you watch the movie, there's a little Easter egg at the end for the Downpour thing. Honestly, and I have to speak to Sammy about this because he owns the rights to it all. But I would like to. There's two things I'd like to do. One, I'd like to make a really low budget version of this, which is full of the kind of the sexual imagery and the real darkness, which would never be mainstream, but really goes into Silent Hill in a twisted way. And also just make up some fresh stories for that world, because the universe is so rich. That to feel that the games have been told, the games, I can't change those, but I can start making up my own stories and seeing where those take me. So, sort of that's how I'd like to do it, really.
You can go everywhere you want with the stories of Silent Hill. You can come back to the original ID. In fact, when we bought the ride, we were thinking to develop Silent Hill 2. And then more we came into trying to tell the story for the people that doesn't know anything about Silent Hill, and we kept up coming with the number one video game, the Silent Hill first. And then we put some of the creature of the number two and the creature of number three, just to give a feel of everything. But now we can come back to number two, we can come back to Downport, we can go anywhere else. It's an extra dimension where everything can happen and lost souls. And there is lost souls everywhere. Look at you guys. A question over here.
This question is for Adelaide. I was wondering, as you were playing the role of Heather, what was your experience, acting with the people who were dressed in the creatures, the horrifying, deformed monsters, the nurses? Like, what was your feeling? What was your experience?
It was. I mean, it was incredible. It was all, they were all the fabric of Silent Hill. So I think that was something to be, to be honored and respected. But I mean, it was so much fun. I adored working on this film, and it was really physically challenging, and a lot of running, jumping, a lot of screaming. I screamed before every take in the film, so.
I think it's going to be on a special edition DVD at some point. We have, we've got every take.
Every take.
Every single take. Adding one.
How many takes would you do a day?
We're not talking about a set of takes. Every time before the clapboard went, she would give this incredibly piercing scream. The sound guys would go, we're about to take, and they just take their cans off for a second. And we'd all step back.
Trying to frighten the monster back?
100 times a day it would be. 100 times a day.
You said you have to do it. Yes, I gotta do it. I have a name, I had a name for all the monsters we have. You've got Brain Monster and Mannequin Monster and, there's all those kinds of things. You've got to go, okay, Red Pyramid, and I think Sam with us.
I think I came with Red Pyramid. I believe we saw it maybe somewhere discussing with Konami, Red Pyramid, because his helmet was red, and it was in the red darkness.
Yeah.
So I think that his Pyramid Head sometimes is Red Pyramid.
Pyramid Head just doesn't sound as cool as Red Pyramid to me. I'm going to tell you. But he has no name, so he is because he comes from the executioners of the from the town. Yeah. So really, he's an embodiment of the executioners. Yeah. When it was a prison colony much earlier. But no, I mean Pyramid Head, Red Pyramid. I inherited the name, so I take no credit for that one way or the other. It was sort of, in many ways, now I think about it, maybe Vincent should never have been called Vincent, because I wanted to use him in a different way, that character. He's a useful character in the game up to a point, and then I always felt that he kind of runs out of steam a little bit when I'm playing the game. Because he does a useful thing, he puts us into a sort of uncomfortable mode. He's trustworthy and yet not trustworthy, and I like that idea a lot, and certainly without wanting to give too much away about how Kit plays Vincent, we use that as a bedrock of an idea. He is in the game, he's knowledgeable about the world, and he obviously helps Heather understand and learn and gives her advice and information which may or may not be true. So it's that ambiguity of his character which I felt was interesting. To change him up, it was just because the narrative of the movie, when you see it, you'll understand, demanded a character that did that kind of thing, and yet what I felt also that she needed somebody else to give her support along the way. So that's how Vincent evolved into what he is in the movie.
Well, thank you so much.
We have time for one more question.
You're very welcome.
Okay. Actually, the last two answered my primary and backup question.
Oh, okay. So we'll jump to this person here.
Oh, no, no, no. I mean, I have another one.
I thought you were telling the tower.
Oh, my
God. I only play Sansa up to 1 to 4.
Right.
Because it takes me so long, the game is too scary. I only play in the daytime. But I did like 4. It's kind of my favorite. I know a lot of people hate it because it never really started as the story of Santa Phil.
Right.
I was just wondering if you were considering using that story as well, even though it's extremely different. It was just, atmosphere-wise, it was a lot more creepy and the soundtrack was amazing.
The truth of the matter is that we needed the correct story which continued the first movie. And 3 is the one that carries that on. So it was never really a debate. Once we decided that we wanted to make a sequel, which was a sequel to the first movie, it had to be 3.
Right.
And it had to be an evolution of that. Now, what I would say is that when you watch the movie, you will see a few characters from other games, just very subtly included in there. Just for the real fans out there who understand why, there's a little cameo at the end, which will rock your socks. But that was just the need of the narrative drove the choices we made to that extent. I mean, you like 4, fine, but 3 feels like it's a kind of creative pinnacle in many ways.
No, 3 was a great choice. I was just wondering, because 4 was so different, is that completely X'd out in any plans?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Are you folks hungry for some more Silent Hill Revelation clips? Out again. We're going to show you some exclusive scenes from the film, including one of my favorite parts of the movie with the mannequin spider. Check it out. Here's some, again, exclusive scenes from Silent Hill Revelation 3D. Revelation. Again, let's give it up for Silent Hill Revelation.